Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to watch the sugar seminar that I've been doing in person all across the Bay Area. About a dozen of these I've done over the past 6 years, 5 years. So without further ado, we'll get into how sweet it isn't, the truth about sugar. All right. And if you aren't already following me on Instagram, come join me at Clean Eating with Katie. That is also my website, cleaneatingwithkatie.com. All right, a little bit more about me. I have been a teacher in Santa Clara Unified School District for about the last 14 years. And midway through in about 2014, I discovered that I had this passion for nutrition and I changed my diet significantly. I noticed huge changes in my health and life. And I just thought, I want to share this with others and I want to learn more about it. So I went back to school. I went to Bowman College, which is in Berkeley, kind of northeast of San Francisco. And I graduated from there in 2016 with a holistic nutrition consulting certification. And that's where I developed this passion for sugar and digestion and just overall health and wellness, the things we can easily do to help us make better choices in our days. And off to the right, you'll see a picture of my husband and I. That's us in Australia of 2019 at the 12 Apostles, which was epic on the Great Ocean Road. And you'll see my children, Molly and Cora. Molly is the tan and white pit bull, and Cora is the pit bull mix. That's sort of this brownish gray. We call her a dirt dog because she blends really well in with the dirt. So that's a little bit about me. And my goal here today is to teach others about the harmful effects of sugar and the benefits of eating whole, real food. So a lot of people will say to me, well, Katie, what's so bad about sugar? You know, it's not that bad. We're over-exaggerating, over-demonizing it. Well, let's take a look. Let's learn a little bit more. It has zero vitamins, zero minerals, zero enzymes, and zero fiber. So it's no nutrients. It's only calories and empty calories at that. It also steals nutrients from our bodies without replacing them. So not only does it not make a deposit into your body, most foods make a deposit and they withdraw some things, but sugar only makes a withdrawal. It's stealing your vitamins and mineral stores, and it crowds out rooms for more nutrient-dense foods. It also really impacts your blood sugar, causing these huge spikes and crashes. It impacts your insulin levels, therefore your hormones. Insulin is a hormone. It also causes you to feel tired, crave more sugar. Then it impacts your body's adrenaline, because when you're at that low, that blood sugar crash, you have to release some adrenaline or get some sugar into your body. So this is not only this blood sugar roller coaster, but it's a hormone roller coaster. And I really like this as a great illustration of what the standard American diet looks like at the top. At the top, we see this lady just eating, you know, processed carbs, lots of sugar in her day. And, you know, she eats them, she feels okay. And then all of a sudden, she's crashing and she just feels horrible. And we go through that throughout the day. And that gets really exhausting and tiring. And if you look to the bottom, you see the whole food glide, which I definitely like this one much better. Not only do you not feel horrible, you do have these normal dips and rises in your blood sugar. And that is normal and healthy. We all need that. But the top version is something that we really can't handle. Our bodies are telling us it's just time for something different. Something else that's really bad about sugar is that it affects our brain chemistry so that we keep craving more. It is 8 times more addictive than cocaine. I have heard a variety of numbers here. 8 times, 2 times, 5 times. Either way, if sugar is even as addictive as cocaine, that sends an alarm bell off in for me. And so we do have these new brain MRI images, not new, but recent brain MRI images of someone on sugar and someone who is on cocaine. And that is the reward dopamine center of the brain that is lighting up there. And you can see from this image that the sugar side has more activity happening on that side than on the cocaine side. So I certainly think it's worth really reconsidering sugar as a food and maybe starting to consider it more as a drug. Well, then some people say, well, okay, you're right. So sugar is not so great, but I can just have a little bit of sugar, right? Well, this is the tricky part, so not so fast. Sugar is a sneaky thing. It's most people feel like they're getting sugar in moderation, but if you take the time to track it, you're actually probably not getting it in moderation. Let's take a look. So here are the sugar synonyms. Now there are more than 50 ways to say the word sugar on a nutrition label without actually putting the word sugar. This is a pretty exhaustive list of all of the other types of sugar. And I have two sort of categories, this left column and then the middle and the right column. So the left column is really the stuff that's less processed. So if you're going to have sugar, these are generally the ones I would recommend. But if you're having all of that, it's still doing the same thing to your body. They're just less processed. So off to the right and the middle, you see the things that are most processed. Agave is something that often shocks people here because they thought it was a low glycemic sweetener, a better sweetener, and it is a low glycemic sweetener. So it will not impact your blood sugar as much as some of the others, but it's really, really processed. The process, what I've been, it's likened to the process of turning corn into high fructose corn syrup, which most of us are well aware of, that not being a health food. And if you think of corn and then how sweet high fructose corn syrup is, it has to go through a lot to get from A to B. And agave, that cactus, same thing. Something else I'd like to point out here is I'm sure not every sugar name is listed here, but I have most of them, and you'll notice I bolded the ones that end in O-S-E. That is anything that's sugar on a label that has O-S-E at the end, like dextrose, fructose, glucose, glucose solids, lactose, levulose, maltodextrose, maltose, sucrose. Those are all types of sugar. So if you see something that ends in OSE on a label and isn't perhaps on this list, then it also is sugar for the body. That's how the body is going to recognize it as sugar. Okay, so we're going to take part in an activity, and I'd like you to participate. So pause the video and do this work. This is the part that really helps you to see what's happening in your own life, in your house. What are you doing? So take some time. Go grab some labels. I'm going to grab some labels here and we'll look at them together, but I'd like you to look at stuff you have in your house. I think that's more practical. And then I'd like you to use that sugar synonyms list to identify as many types of sugars as you can find in the label. And then ask yourself, were there any things that surprised you? So I'm gonna go back here, take a screenshot, and it's Control Shift 3 on a Mac will get you the whole thing. And there should be print screen on a PC. On a Chromebook, I think it's Shift, and then there's a box with two lines above it. It's like above the four. That should be your screenshot. So take a screenshot so you've got this while I talk you through this next step here. All right, so I've got some labels here, and we can take a look at them. This is some Fiber One bars. So here I see semi-sweet chocolate has sugar, got corn syrup, barley flakes could be sugar again, maltodextrin, sugarcane fiber. I'm not sure if that will be actual sugar, fructose, malt extract. That's probably it. So that was like five different kinds of sugar there. Let's grab something else. Toaster strudels. We've got high fructose corn syrup, sugar, maltodextrin, dextrose, and then you have 2% or less of, but you still have some more strawberry puree. That's obviously going to have sugar in it. It's got corn syrup solids. What else we got here? Sucralose down at the bottom. Okay, so that was again like five or six kinds of sugar. Let's see. How about kashi? You know, seven whole grains on a mission, right? We have dried cane syrup. Brown rice, barley, got canola oil, cinnamon. Oh, only one kind of sugar. Good to know. Doesn't mean I like them, but power bars. This one's got maltol syrup, chocolate flavored coating, which have sugar in it. Oligo fructose, that was not on our list, but it has that os and has a fructose in it, so you know it's a sugar. Fructose, cane invert syrup. And so that's about it. Still, quite a handful of sugar items in there. All right, so hopefully you had a chance to look at some things at your house and see what you noticed as well. And we'll get back to the presentation and talk about what are some common trends that people often notice. Okay, hopefully you've had a chance to look at things that were in your pantry, and you also had a chance to look at things that I have packages of. Some things to note. Most people note that, oh, there's more than one kind of sugar here. That's often on there. And they'll also note that sometimes it will say 0 grams of sugar on the nutrition facts, but below it in the ingredients, there will be sugar. Let's address these couple of things as well as what's here on the slide. So here's is reduced fat wheat thins. And something to note that ingredients on labels are listed in the order with the highest quantity listed first, and then things get less in quantity as you go down the list. And so manufacturers intentionally use multiple types of sugar so that sugar is not listed as the number one ingredient. So here's this example of reduced fat wheat thins: whole grain wheat flour, then sugar, then soybean oil, cornstarch, malt syrup from corn and barley, salt, and refiner syrup. So you have 3 kinds of sugar in here. And if we put all of those together and just, you know, however much that concentration would be, I don't know, but it could be more than the wheat flour. So this is sort of sneaky. The other thing is like refiner syrup or malt syrup don't catch my eye as much as the word sugar, right? That just the way we are. So if we're skimming for something, it's just the way we are. So it's deceptive in that way, both of those ways. The other thing that I like folks to notice, when you look at nutrition facts labels, you also have to pay attention to that serving size, because sometimes that serving size is so small that there's less than 0.5 gram of something per serving, and they don't have to then list it in the, you know, in the numbers part of the nutrition facts label. That goes for trans fats as well. I would say 0 grams of trans fat on the front of the label, but in the ingredients, you'll see partially hydrogenated, whatever kind of oil listed, which is a trans fat. So how can they do that? Same thing, is there's less than 0.5 gram per serving. So it's still in there. It's just not very much, or not as much as it used to be, and is now less than 0.5 gram per serving. So there are lots of tactics that these, big box food, these big food companies can do to make things look and sound better to us, the consumer, and that we often don't know about. So I think that's really important to know. Something that's not on here either, but I want you to know, is that there's something called GRAS, G-R-A-S, generally regarded as safe. So a lot of these foods will have things like BHT in them, which are generally regarded as safe. It means the FDA has said, in general, this food is a safe food. You don't have to put it on there. But perhaps this is something that actually bothers you. Perhaps you're sensitive to it. You may or may not know. But there are ingredients that are in your foods that do not have to be listed, which I find abhorrent, to be honest. The other thing is they're generally regarded as safe as an individual ingredient. They do not take into account what else is in the food ingredient list, or perhaps you're eating that in 4 or 5 or 6 different things throughout the day and you don't even know it because it's not listed on the ingredient. This is one of the reasons why I'm a big proponent of real whole food and avoiding packaged food, because we don't know everything in the packaged food, even if we are being good consumers and reading the nutrition labels. It's just a very system that is set up for us, the consumer, to fail at, which is the sad truth. Okay, I'm going to, in the next slide, put up some foods. And I want you to think about how many grams of sugar as in each food. And I want you to think about what order you would want these foods in, to be from least to greatest. So we're going to have a variety of foods come on the screen. And you'd imagine that we're assuming 1 serving size, unless I've noted it. All right, so here we go. I'm going to show you foods. They'll come up one by one. And I want you to think in relation to each other, was this more or less sugar? Kind of putting it on a number line, if you will. We have one can of Coca-Cola. Now we have the vanilla ice cream from Häagen-Dazs, 1 cup of that. Where would that go in relation to the Coke, more or less? What about a 1 cup container of the Yoplait Light yogurt strawberry flavor? Where would that go? What about 3 chocolate chip cookies? These are Chips Ahoy soft chocolate chip cookies. This is 1 serving. Or what about 1 cup of the low-fat frozen yogurt vanilla flavored? Is that more or less than the regular ice cream? How does it compare to Coke? How does it compare to the cookies? And here we have the non-light version of the Yoplait yogurt strawberry flavor. Where would that go? And these are 2. This is 1 serving of Pop-Tarts. This is the cherry-flavored Pop-Tarts. Is that more or less than Coke or vanilla ice cream? What about raspberry sorbet? The same company, Häagen-Dazs, 1 cup of raspberry sorbet. Where would that go in relation? And last but not least, I have 2. This is 1 serving of graham crackers. 2 graham crackers. Where would that go? You might need a piece of paper or to think about this a little bit longer. So go ahead and take a moment. Think about what do you think has the most sugar, what has the least. And then as I reveal this, let's talk about what's surprising here. So we have least at the top, greatest at the bottom. Graham crackers, not that surprising that they're the least. Chips Ahoy, those cookies, but only 1/2 teaspoon more. That is what I find interesting. 3 cookies, 1/2 teaspoon more. Yoplait Light, 3.5. Vanilla ice cream is next. I think that probably is a shocker for a lot of people. Vanilla frozen yogurt, they're the same. They're tied, I should say. Sorbet actually has another teaspoon of sugar in comparison to the ice cream and the frozen yogurt, which is often surprising for most. It's also the same as a Yoplait yogurt. So you could have ice cream and have 1 teaspoon less of sugar. That generally shocks people. Pop-Tarts, not shocking for most, but what I think is interesting is only 1 teaspoon away from Coke. And what I like to say here is that, and people have Pop-Tarts for breakfast. Coke, it's not commonly thought of as a breakfast food, but people have Pop-Tarts for breakfast. One time at a sugar seminar, one woman volunteered that she used to have both for breakfast, Coke and a Pop-Tart, Pop-Tarts. And so that's, you know, we're going to get into what are the sugar recommendations momentarily, but that is the part that's like, ugh. And this is also the story that I like to tell here. So some of these things are certainly shocking. What's shocking to me is graham crackers. Mostly because when I worked in childcare before I became a teacher, we had these state-approved menus of snacks that we used to serve, and graham crackers was always on there. And 2 is the starting amount kids could have, 2 graham crackers. But have you ever had 2 graham crackers and felt A, full, or B, satisfied? No, most people eat a whole sleeve and they feel like they're making a better choice because it's graham crackers and not cookies. So again, here's that bit about Pop-Tarts and Coke. So one can of Coke is just 1 teaspoon more than a Pop-Tart. And again, then you get, and this is the small size, right? What about people who are choosing this larger size or this larger size? This is the part that I like to point out about the graham crackers, is that graham crackers are a common snack for kids. They're thought of to be healthy and healthful. And they, you know, here the label says it has 5 grams of whole grains. You know, it's not that unhealthy, but you could get this whole snack pack of Chips Ahoy for 3.5 grams of sugar, or just 1 serving, 3 grams of sugar. I mean, and get 2.5 grams of sugar, or even the Oreos is only 3.5 teaspoons of sugar, of the 2 teaspoons of sugar that we're getting with the graham crackers. So it's just a perception. I also think you might turn over a label and say, oh, it has 3 grams of sugar, or it has 4 grams of sugar. and think, okay, that's not too bad. But when you look at them in comparison to something that you're like, yeah, I don't think this one is low in sugar, like the Coca-Cola. We all know that that's high in sugar. It's a sugary beverage. But so are you, we're often not comparing them side by side in that moment at the store or when we're choosing that option. So if we had to compare it to Coke, which you know is high in sugar, then at least you could get a to compare things to, because otherwise we're kind of just comparing them. Oh, it doesn't sound so bad. Three. Well, three what? Three in comparison to what? And how, and are you having the serving size that is indicated here? All right. Here we're going to bring in two of my favorite documentaries. Super Size Me, if you haven't seen it, came out, I think, in 2002. I watched it way back when. I think I even owned it. Was where Morgan Spurlock turned himself into a science experiment by eating McDonald's for 30 days. He could only have McDonald's. And if they asked him to supersize it, he had to say yes. That was part of his rules of this experiment. At the end, you know, he took blood work before and blood work after, and he met with doctors regularly. But at the end, he had sexual dysfunction, a fatty liver, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. He gained weight, and overall, he just felt terrible. Now, inspired by Super Size Me, Damon Gameau turned himself into a science experiment for 60 days in that sugar film, which you can rent for just a couple bucks. I think I grabbed it on Amazon. He changed his diet to only the added sugar of the average Australian, because he's Australian, which is 40 teaspoons of sugar. So he was trying to be just the standard Australian diet. He kept his activity level the same and his calorie level the same. And he only ate what we would call, might consider health foods. These would be things like low-fat yogurts, healthy cereals. He'd have vitamin water. He had his sports drinks, perhaps a fruit smoothie, bread. He was not seeking out candy or sodas or quote-unquote junk foods. He was avoiding those and trying to stick with what just people are picking up, thinking that they're healthy options, and perhaps they're not. The shocking bit was that his results were similar to Morgan Spurlock's. In 16 days, he gained about 15 pounds. He increased his cholesterol and triglycerides, because sugar is really the culprit there. Liver enzymes were also increased, meaning he's getting a fatty liver, that non-alcoholic fatty liver. He had acne, skin problems. He gained 10 inches around his waist. He was lethargic and had mood disturbances. It was a really good film, and I highly recommend checking it out.
After just 2 days of the experiment, I was amazed at how easy it was to get to 40 teaspoons without eating any junk food. I've just had a breakthrough as to how we might be consuming so much fructose. I just bought these 4 apples. Now I know that if I tried to eat these apples, I'd probably get through 2 of them and I'd feel full. The fiber in the fruit would tell my body to stop. It's had enough to eat. But I want to see what happens if I can juice these 4 apples. Right, so that's 4 apples. That's the sugar from 4 apples in 1 glass. Now, 1 apple is about 4 teaspoons of sugar, so that's 16 teaspoons of sugar in that glass. See, nature has given us this perfect little packet, and it's got all the nutrients, the fiber that tells us when we're full, and just the right amount of sugar in this. But what we do is we invent a machine like this, which extracts only the sugar, and then we throw everything else away.
All right, so I hope that you enjoyed that little clip. I used to be a big proponent of juice. I never was a soda fan. Not that I never have it, but I just knew that it really wasn't healthy for me. And so really tried to watch my soda intake. And I was like, but I like juice. Juice is fine. It's natural. Turns out that it's got just as much sugar, if not more, and it's doing the same thing as soda, which is hard to hear, but is the reality. Your body doesn't know, oh, this is fruit versus this is high fructose corn syrup. It doesn't know. It's like, this is sugar. Here's what I do when I have sugar. So might be hard to hear, but it's certainly the truth and the hard lesson that we kind of have to learn. All right, so everything in moderation, right? We just kind of talked about how that's been much easier said than done. Everyone says it, but are we able to really do it? So the American Heart Association recommends this. This is their current recommendation. These are for added sugars. This is what the American Heart Association recommends for men, women, and children. So 9 teaspoons a day for men, 6 teaspoons a day for women, and for children. The average American consumes an average of 25 teaspoons, which is a half a cup per day. That adds up to 100 pounds a year. Now you'll note that Damon Gameau was getting 40 teaspoons a day, which is the average Australian has. I think this number of 25 teaspoons is too low because I've also heard numbers as high as 50 teaspoons a day. Either way, whether you want to go low or go high, it's still way too much. Those 2.5 teaspoons for the Chips Ahoy, 9.5 teaspoons for the Coke is already more than any of us should have in one day. All right. So I have a jar that I will show you in just a moment of sugar. Okay. And I'd like you to take a moment to guess the amount of sugar in pounds in the jar. So we're talking about at least 100 pounds of added sugar Americans are getting in 1 year. So this jar has the average American consumes this amount in 1 month. All right, here we go. I want you to guess how much sugar this is. Okay, so you can see how big it is, about the size of my head. This is a trifle dish, I believe. The activity for you is, how much sugar is this? I said the hint was this is what the average American consumes in about a month. And this is with that low estimate of 100 pounds in a year. So it's getting heavy to hold. If you guessed 8 pounds, a little over 8 pounds, you would be right. This is a little over 8 pounds of sugar. And that's what the average American is getting in 1 month. When you see it all like that, it's kind of shocking, right? All right, we're going to move on to another activity about how much sugar did I have in an average day. So we're going to figure out just an average day of my life before I made, you know, sort of the shift to real whole foods. And then I want to encourage you to do the same, because I don't think you know how much sugar you're eating until you've taken a look at it. And with data, data is power. So with that data, then you can make changes and you can make actionable goals. But you cannot, it's hard to do that if you don't have that data. So we're going to assume there's not a perfect conversion for grams and teaspoons, but we're going to assume that each gram is about a quarter of a teaspoon. So the equation is grams divided by 4 will get you to teaspoons. Okay, so if you want to screenshot this, and fill this in for yourself. So actually all of the food that I have is from Trader Joe's. That's where I really shopped very frequently in my mid-20s when I kind of was eating this way before I made a big change to my diet. That is not to pick on Trader Joe's. You could get this exact same thing at any grocery store, or exact same numbers essentially at any grocery store. But my go-to breakfast before I changed my diet was a bowl of cereal. I would use an alternative milk, often coconut milk or almond milk. So together, that vanilla, almond, granola, and milk was 2 grams and 8 grams, which when I add that together, you get about 20. Divide that by 4, you get 5 teaspoons. And again, I'd have a snack at recess. Often yogurt was one of my go-to snacks. Strawberry yogurt from Trader Joe's, the European style one, 20 grams of sugar, which again, another 5 teaspoons. For lunch, I'd often get their prepackaged salads or frozen meals. Not that this would be every day, but this was pretty regular occurrence. So a broccoli, kale, and chicken salad that they have. This one happens to have some dried cranberries, and I think it had like a sort of a sweet balsamic. So it had 19 grams of sugar. So here we are again, pretty much at 20 grams each of these 3 times. So that's another 4¾ teaspoon of sugar. You can see how it's really hard to be moderate with your sugar, especially when none of these was like candy or soda or even juice. Would often have peanut butter sandwich crackers, again, for that protein in them. Those weren't too bad, only 3 grams. So that's 3/4 teaspoon. Dinner would often get, they have black bean and corn enchiladas, which are pretty decent. And I would get that has 4 grams, which is only 1 teaspoon. Again, not too bad there. I will say, though, everything else I'm assuming serving sizes, all of these ones I've assumed serving sizes, but here, they only said you could have 1 enchilada, and I know I never ate 1 enchilada for my dinner or lunch. It was definitely the whole package. So I did put the whole package here. Oh, the rest of these are all, I've assumed, serving sizes. And then I'd often get like a chocolate, you know, an M&M or chocolate or peanut butter and dried fruit and nuts trail mix. That was very common also. That 16 grams of sugar. So that's 4 teaspoons right there. We add all of that up. I was getting about 20 and a half teaspoons of sugar in a day, all without really, the only candy I might have would be a couple of bits of chocolate chips or M&Ms in the trail mix. I was not eating a candy bar ever. And I want you to remember that the American Heart Association recommends that 6 teaspoons of added sugar per day for women. So I was getting over 3 times that amount. So again, even without, just like Damon Gameau, I was not seeking out high sugar things, but it was all adding up. So again, I'd like to encourage you to do this for yourself, just for one day. Take just a snapshot of time, maybe 2, maybe 3, whatever you'd like, but just get some data for yourself. See where you're at. Okay, so here I am. I'm going to say the thing that nobody wants to really hear. We are eating way too much sugar. As a culture, as a country, we are eating way too much sugar. And it's causing a huge impact on our health. These are some of the things that sugar has been doing to our bodies. Acne, it adds a strain on the liver, adrenal fatigue, Alzheimer's, anxiety, depression, arthritis, cancer, chronic back pain. It's converted to fat as triglycerides. That might ring a bell when I mentioned earlier that Damon Gameau had high triglycerides and high cholesterol. Fatigue, headaches, heart disease, hormone imbalances, hypertension, infertility, insulin resistance, metabolic syndrome, and type 2 diabetes. Those are all sort of on a spectrum. You get insulin resistance, then you get metabolic syndrome, and then you get those are sort of the pre-diabetic bit, and then you get type 2 diabetes. Joint pain, moodiness, muscle aches, nutrient depletion, obesity, ovarian cysts, painful periods, skin irritations, suppressed immune function, tooth decay, and yeast overgrowth because we're constantly feeding it. Now, this is a pretty extensive list, and some of these things are not the end of the world. You know, acne and cancer are not on the same level, but none of them are things I think any of us wants to have. Nobody wants joint pain or muscle aches. Nobody wants skin irritations. Okay, so they're all bad. Some are just significantly harder to deal with. All right, so we're going to talk about sugar as a chronic stressor. No matter where you get off on this bus route, any of these leads to stress in the body. So it can just be some nutrient depletion, but that's a stress signal in the body. It can also continue on and lead to inactivate your B vitamins because your B vitamins are really used in the processing of sugar in the body. But again, if you have low B vitamin stores, you're leading to stress. You know, then B vitamins are really linked to our energy. They are something that we need to sustain our energy. And when it's being used to process sugar, we're going to have low energy. And again, that's a stress signal in the body. That can lead to poor repair and maintenance of all of your tissues and organs and body parts. And that, again, signals stress. Poor repair and maintenance can lead to any disease or health condition. And again, that leads to stress. All roads lead to stress here. And those, any diseases and health conditions can lead to chronic inflammation, needing to be on prescription drugs and surgery. And all of those, again, are stress in the body. So there really is no two ways about it. Sugar is a chronic stressor for our bodies. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the immune system. A lot of you know that the immune health is a passion of mine based on the fact that I am a breast cancer survivor and that I have an immune deficiency called common variable immune deficiency. So I have to be really careful and do everything in my power, at least in my opinion. I have to do everything in my power to keep my immune system as strong as possible so that I can avoid getting sick because it's hard for me to bounce back. Sugar intake is tied to immune suppression. So basically, it's weakening your immune system's innate immune system's ability to do its job when you come across pathogens in the wild. Okay. Ingestion of sugar impedes the ability of neutrophils to destroy bacteria for 30 minutes to up to 5 hours after ingestion. So neutrophils are one of our body's early defense mechanisms, and they are unable to destroy bacteria after we consume sugar for quite a long time, up to 5 hours after. So perhaps what happens in cold and flu season, or sugar season as I like to call it, from about October through January, February, we're eating a lot of sugar. If you think of, you get like baking pie season in the fall, and then you get Halloween candy and Halloween, and then Thanksgiving and Thanksgiving treats and things that keep lasting. And then you get Christmas and all the baked goods that go along with Christmas. And then everybody has to get rid of them, but they still have all the sugar. And then Valentine's Day comes around. We're just constantly being bombarded with sugar and weakening our immune system. That's not to say that it's all sugar's fault. There are germs that we encounter, but we're certainly having a lot more sugar in that season than most other seasons. And it's a pretty long one. Ingestion of sugar also reduces the lymphocyte count. Now, lymphocytes are these T cells that destroy invaders, and it reduces the lymphocyte counts for up to 2 hours. And when lymphocytes are reduced, so is the production of antibodies. And this causes the body to then excrete minerals, especially zinc, which, as we know, is basically is able to stop viral replication and kill viruses. So it's a major immune system mineral. And ingestion of sugar also causes hyperimmune reactions. So your immune system's on hyperdrive instead of underfunctioning. It increases symptoms in those with allergic rhinitis, which is allergies. So what I encourage you to do, if you do decide to give up sugar for a period of time, track your allergies and see how they do. A lot of folks that I've worked with say, my allergies were totally gone when I took out the sugar. I know it's true for me. So here's the thing. Most people have no idea how good their body is designed to feel. I was in high school, I started experiencing acid reflux. I didn't know what it was really, but I just had this metallic taste in my mouth. And I was like, gosh, it's kind of annoying. Whenever I eat lunch, this is annoying. And then as I grew older, I started getting heartburn. And again, it's not a big deal, but it just kind of became normal for me. And I didn't really want to seek out a prescription or anything for it. That's just not my approach to things. I just thought it was normal because everybody had it. People would say, oh, it's this, oh, it's that. And I just thought, oh, well, I just deal with heartburn and acid reflux. Well, what it really is common. It is not normal. Common because lots of people deal with it, but it's not a normal part of the human experience. I was having too much gluten. And I could track it because back in high school, when I first started getting these symptoms, I would have these blueberry loaf or lemon poppy seed loaf, sounded like a muffin, but bigger. And that was my lunch every day because, you know, I made good choices like most high schoolers do. And I had every single day for lunch, and that was exactly tied to it. So I know it was that. And I would report it, this heartburn, after I would eat pizza specifically. And people would say, oh, it's the tomatoes. Turns out it was the gluten. I noticed it when I took gluten out of my diet and then brought it back in and had some toast, and I got that heartburn back right away. And I was like, all right, now I know exactly what this is. So there is a big difference between common and normal. And so most of us have been dealing with these sort of nagging, aching problems, maybe not huge issues, but these small problems for a long time, and they just become normal to us, but they're actually not. And there is a pain and symptom-free way of living. There is a better way. Some of the benefits that my participants have remarked to me, so these are all, you know, other people's experiences of what they've noticed. They have increased energy. They have more stable mood. So that hormone roller coaster, they're not on anymore and they're feeling good. And so their moods are better. They get better, more restful sleep. There is reduced inflammation in the body. A lot of people say, I don't have any joint pain anymore. My knees aren't hurting. My elbow isn't hurting. They have clearer skin. Something big that I noticed for myself. Improved immune function. Again, I definitely can testify to that. So can my clients in the past. Clearer thinking. Control over cravings. And possible weight loss. And possible improved blood work. I love these ones, those folks that do blood work before and after, because you really get some good data. This were a couple of things that some folks reported to me in the past. One of my participants was very anemic, and her ferritin levels, one of the markers of iron in the body, was the highest it had been in 8 years. It's pretty significant. The same participant also checked her blood sugar levels. Her blood work before, the blood sugar levels were 100 milligrams per deciliter, which is basically pre-diabetic. At 100, 101 is when they start having some concerns if your fasting blood sugar is at that level. 70 to 100 is normal, but again, that 100 is really the cutoff for starting to be concerned. And so really anywhere near that, it should be an indicator that we could be needing to get blood sugar under control. Okay, but afterwards, after removing sugar from her diet, it was 87 milligrams per deciliter, which is significantly better and much more in that healthy range. And her husband had done his blood work before as well, and he had improved blood pressure, which was really exciting to hear because that was a concern for him. So what can you do instead? What can you do instead of the standard American diet? Well, I have a program called The Real Food Reset. It is a 4-week plan to reset your palate, change your behaviors, and to get you feeling great again. Okay? It is real food, no gimmicks. The goal is to give you a solid path onto long-term behavior changes, because not only is it the actual act of changing your diet for those 4 weeks that's important, but it's the behavior changes that you take with you long term. Not that you stick with everything long term, but the goal is to walk away with some big takeaways that work best for you long term. And so what you'll get is meal plans, shopping list, recipes, and all the support you would expect from a nutrition coach. That's me, by the way. Now, there is two versions of this. One is where you really get the printed program. That's this version. Just the materials. That's what you need to do it all on your own, and you get some check-ins with me. But if you want even more support, because even more support is what you really need, you've tried this before, you've tried working on making changes to your diet, and you never stick with it, then you'll want to work with me. And you get 3 live calls. So we'll do like Zoom calls before, during, and after the Real Food Reset. I give you suggestions for how to dine out while doing this, because that is often people's biggest barrier, and often when they throw in the towel or have a big slip up and have to start fresh. I also have a product sample snack pack. This is often a big helper for folks. They just don't really know where do I get foods that I can eat instead? I need some swaps. That's what this is, filled with foods that you can have on the Real Food Reset. There's daily educational videos and daily engagement, interaction, inspiration, because I know what you often need is someone on the sidelines cheering you on, someone to ask questions to, someone to be there for support. So this is that version of that, really, that one-on-one coaching model. Thank you so much for spending the time with me today. I want you to leave you with this quote: do the best you can until you know better, and then when you know better, do better. All right, if you have any questions, email me at cleanunionwithkatie@gmail.com. Check out this, all this information is located on my website, cleaneatingwithkatie.com. You click on the Work With Me tab and you'll scroll down and see this real food reset information there. All right, have a great, wonderful day. Thank you so much for tuning in. It would mean the world to me if you take the moment to follow me on Facebook or Instagram, share this with a friend or family member that you think would benefit from it, and leave a comment below. Hit the subscribe channel as well. Thank you and have a wonderful day.